Welcome to this video from a collaboratory of 23 synergy circles of the evolutionary leaders. Initiated just this year, 2023, for the evolutionary leaders and its 23 areas of activist engagement, and centering on issues of the divine feminine, divine child, and women's and children's issues around the world. I'm Dr. Kurt Johnson, coordinator of the Synergy Circles, and I'll be joined in these initial videos by collaboratory founders and prominent leaders and activists, Denise Scotto, JD, Laura George, JD, and Dr. Jude Kuravan, along with Rian Eisler, JD, renowned author on these global issues. All of them working together, along with others, on this emerging activist collaboratory of the Evolutionary Leaders Circle, a project of the Source of Synergy Foundation. In these initial discussions, they will lay out much of the landscape for these important areas of global engagement, based on Dr. Eisler's famous four cornerstones of how our world can move from dominance consciousness and dominance cultures to partnership consciousness and partnership cultures. In each video, we'll begin by introducing Dr. Eisler and the four cornerstones, and then the featured guest for the episode. Rian Eisler, JD, PhD, is a best-selling author, system scientist, futurist, cultural historian, and attorney, whose work shows how to build a more equitable, sustainable, and less violent world. Her famous book, The Chalice and the Blade, Our History, Our Future, is now in 57 U.S. printings and 30 foreign editions. Dr. Eisler is president of the Center for Partnership Systems, CPS, and editor-in-chief of the Interdisciplinary Journal of Partnership Studies at the University of Minnesota. She is also the author of Nurturing Our Humanity, How Domination and Partnership Structure Our Brains, Lives, and Future, co-authored with anthropologist Dr. Douglas Fry, Oxford University Press, 2019, and The Real Wealth of Nations, Creating a Caring Economics, hailed by Nobel Peace Laureate Archbishop Desmond Tutu as the template for the better world that we are so urgently seeking. In short, according to dictionaries, a domination hierarchy is a social hierarchy arising when interaction of members of a social system creates a ranking system. Such rankings of who are favored can involve gender, race, economic status, and so on. Dr. Eisler's four cornerstones of how we shift from domination consciousness to partnership consciousness are these, and we invite you to hear our first video with Dr. Eisler, in which she elaborates these four elements. The first cornerstone is childhood. Second cornerstone is the attitude toward gender. The third cornerstone is economics, and the fourth cornerstone is story and language. So let's go over now to introduce our guest for this episode. The guest for this discussion is the Reverend Laura M. George, JD. Laura serves as executive director of the Oracle Institute. The Oracle Institute is a 501c3 educational charity, a spiritual think tank that studies the nexus between religion, politics, human rights, and conscious evolution. Oracle is headquartered at the Peace Pentagon, the conference and retreat center located along the ancient river in Independence, Virginia. Oracle offers a wide variety of progressive and pluralistic programming, including a spirituality school, award-winning publishing house, and an international peace practice. Oracle Campus is also the home of the Valley of Light micro-community, co-founded by Laura and other cultural creatives. Laura is also the lead minister of the Oracle Temple and Esoteric Church. She received her undergraduate degree in commerce from the University of Virginia and her law degree from Boston University, and her ministerial training through the Interfaith Order of Melchizedek. She's the author of the award-winning Oracle Trilogy, The Truth, the Love, and the Light, and is a member of the Evolutionary Leader Circle and a co-founding admin, along with Denise Scotto, JD, of the Synergy Circles Collaboratory, providing these video discussions. And you can learn more at theoracleinstitute.org and peacepentagon.net. So over now to Rian Eisler and Laura George. So welcome to Laura George and Rian Eisler, who we've just told you so much about. So let's start with Rian's breakdown of dominator versus partnership cultural models. Rian, your body of work focuses on two primary cultural paths that societies have adopted throughout human history: dominator and partnership models. Dominator models are based on male supremacy, hierarchy, and often violence, whereas partnership models are based on gender equality, nurturing values, and greater peace and stability. Do you see these models as existing side by side throughout history? Or if not, at what point in human history do you see that we had this spike to dominator cultures?
Well, thank you, Kurt, and it's a pleasure to be with you, Laura. Well, I first want to distinguish between history and prehistory, because my first book, The Chalice and the Blade, Our History, Our Future, is the subtitle, really is a look at some events that took place in prehistory and led to what I describe further in the book, a domination-oriented or dominator-oriented history. And of course, we don't know what really happened in prehistory, except we can make inferences from archaeological findings, more recently from DNA studies, from all kinds of non-deciphered, because they did have some writing then, but hasn't been deciphered, records. So to answer your question, Kurt, first of all, it is very likely that when the split happened from gathering, hunting, and I put gathering first, because most of our calories were from gathering, not from hunting, when that split technologically occurred, one part of the split was towards early farming, and the other part of the split, which happened in the more, in the less fertile regions of our globe, where, if you will, the earth was not as good of a mother, it was a shift to herding. And I believe that what happened then is that in the mainstream of our cultural direction, because gathering hunting societies were more oriented towards the partnership system, in the early farming societies, the tradition of partnership, of gender equity, of a more generally egalitarian culture, like we see in Çatalhöyük, for example. And of course, in Çatalhöyük, for example, there, we don't see any signs of destruction through warfare in the archaeological record for 1,000 years. I mean, that's a long time. But in the less fertile areas, I believe that the split led to herding. And herding itself, of course, creates climate change. We are seeing that today. But herding is also an area where it's more likely to have the domination, because I'm not a determinist, to have the domination system occur. So what happened, though, between climate change, between aridification, even these marginal areas of the globe, it was harder and harder to sustain life. And what happened, and the archaeologist Maria Gimbutas, who was very much pushed to the periphery until DNA studies showed that, yes, that what she says most likely happened exactly when she said it did. These Kurgans, or Indo-European hordes, came down with their herding and their domination system and pretty much replaced the earlier cultures, including most of the earlier people, at least most of the men, because that's what the DNA shows. And that happened about 5 to 10,000 years ago. So, but I really want to emphasize, and I think this takes us really to what Laura will talk about, what happened was not just force. What happened is a massive, massive remything, a massive change of the stories that are considered truths, you know, I mean, really immutable truths, like religious ones. And that took millennia, really, to happen. But it did. And we've inherited a lot of that false stories.
Okay, let's turn now to Oracle's trickle-down deity model. Laura, the Oracle Institute also has studied these various cultural models throughout human history. And I know that your model has a spiritual component that also tracks the shifting godhead over the eons. Can you explain your map and how it relates to gender relations and Rayan's body of work?
Yes, and it's very similar to Rayan's models. We've broken down the ages of humankind by focusing on the shifting godhead, meaning humanity's evolving concept of deity from the dawn of consciousness forward. And what we've noticed is that there have been 5 such major shifts. And before I briefly describe each one of those shifts, I just want to let you know that what the trickle-down deity theory posits is that our everyday reality and how we react to everyday life is pretty much based on our concept of God, and it trickles down into all the frontline ways in which we encounter and deal with the world. So what we've noticed is that when the Godhead shifts, that's when the paradigm shifts. And these are the 5 ages of humankind in our model. So the first one is primordial oneness. So this was not a stage that humans crafted in any sense of the word. For those of you who are fundamentalists and love the Bible, you can think of it as the period in the Garden of Eden. But for those of us who are more science oriented, this would be like pre-Big Bang, before evolution begins to occur in the cosmos. Then the first time humans did craft a belief system, this mates up perfectly with Rianne's early partnerism in prehistory. We call this the second paradigm, and this was the era of the Great Mother. And we know that almost uniformly from archaeological evidence and cave paintings and things like that, that early humans viewed God as a female deity. Then around the same time Rianne's describing, about, you know, 5000 BC, when the Great River Valley civilizations start forming, that's when we see the next shift in the Godhead. And these are the pantheons of gods and goddesses, starting with like the Sumerian pantheon and moving forward in time to the Egyptian, the Roman, Greek. And this paradigm lasted for about 5,000 years. And this is when we start to see relationships harden between men and women. And then the next paradigm, where we're still a little stuck, we call the era of God the Father. And this was ushered in by the Abrahamic religions. And this is when we really see the dominator model kick into high gear. And this is what the next paradigm, what we call the fifth paradigm, is attempting to replace with partnerism, the body of work that Rianne is so famous for. So there's a direct correlation between like our second paradigm of the Great Mother and the early partnerism period of human evolution, and also this desire to get into this next paradigm, the fifth paradigm, during which we believe the Godhead will become more sophisticated in terms of how humans view deity, And hopefully partnership will be the model that replaces, finally, the dominator system that has been in effect for so long.
All right, so let's see if we can kind of find out where we're at now in the cycle. So, Rihanna, it appears that you and Laura agree that partnerism is really attempting a major cultural comeback. So let's dig into what is actually thwarting this evolutionary progress toward a greater feminine values and toward the divine feminine. Despite the recent gains that partnership model seems to have had in the 20th century, when women's rights started to become anchored, what do you think is still preventing humans from reaching gender equity and better gender relationships, which is your second cornerstone?
Well, first of all, thank you, Laura. And again, Kurt, thank you for the question. I want to say that in this era of the veneration of the power to give and nurture life and the cyclic nature of really existence, I don't think from my research, and if you look at the figure in the front of the chalice and the blade, you kind of see this rather vividly. It wasn't only the veneration of a quote goddess, because she really, I mean, that figure has breasts and she's a bird goddess, and she's also phallic in shape. So I think it was more the unity of life, both in terms of gender, both male and female, and everybody in between, of course. And then the second phase, I think we were already beginning to shift towards the domination system, but it was very hard to get rid of the goddess and the female divinity. And so, but it is a period during which, let's take a look at Shiva and Shakti. I mean, Shiva, in some of the depictions, is twice, three times, four times the size of Shakti. And that shows that. But to get to your question, and forgive me, because I just wanted to add that. Yes, I mean, modern history, the period of disequilibrium when the Industrial Revolution started to go into high gear, marked a lot of progressive movements, all of which challenged the same thing, a tradition of domination. I mean, think about it for a moment. The so-called Enlightenment rights of man movement challenged the so-called divinely ordained right of kings to rule their quote subjects. The abolitionist movement, the civil rights movement, the anti-colonial movement challenged another tradition of domination. Again, the so-called divinely ordained right of a quote superior race to rule over quote inferior ones. The feminist movement challenged again the so-called divinely ordained right of men to rule over the women and children to which they were confined, really, in the quote castles, you know, a military metaphor of their homes, all the way to the environmental movement challenging man's once hallowed, right, conquest and domination of nature. But these movements really have primarily tried to dismantle what I call the top of the domination pyramid, which is, of course, a politics and economics as conventionally defined in through these very old operating systems that we acquired, through our domination traditions that we've inherited. And they left very much intact what Laura really emphasized, gender. Well, actually, if you look at our conventional categories, right, left, religious, secular, Eastern, Western, Northern, Southern, capitalist, socialist, they all either ignore or marginalize nothing less than the majority of humanity, women and children, and hence families, okay? So what you have is that when, again, during this period of great disequilibrium, as we shift from the industrial, primarily manufacturing, to the post-industrial knowledge service era, another period of this equilibrium, this conflict between the partnership movement to really reconnect with a configuration, not to go back to any quote good old days, is accelerating, but so also the domination resistance is becoming fiercer and fiercer. Rise of strongman rule, anti-women crusade, anti-gay crusade, anti-trans crusade. In other words, holding on to these rigid gender stereotypes, because how else are you going to rank masculinity over, quote, femininity, unless you have very, very rigid gender stereotypes. So this is a tremendous obstacle. And unfortunately, and we're working very hard to change this, many people who consider themselves progressive still are not focused on the fact that gender is not just a, quote, women's issue or just a gender issue. It is a primary social and economic organizing principle in both, yes, in both partnership-oriented and domination-oriented systems. In domination-oriented systems, you see it very clearly. Anything that's coded feminine, like caring for children, caring for the elderly, I don't have to tell you, we have a hidden system of gendered values, and we have to unpack it, make it visible, and change it. So I urge everyone who is listening to pay attention to gender and, of course, also childhood, because my latest book, for example, Nurturing Our Humanity, which was published by Oxford University Press in 2019, draws heavily from neuroscience. And it shows that this whole argument between nature and nurture is, again, a distraction, just as the argument between capitalism and socialism really is a distraction. We inherited both from early industrial times, and they both perpetuate this gendered system of values. And I'll be happy to talk about that if we have time. But we really need to pay attention to these cornerstones, to these foundations, if we are to really, and we have to change the norms, yes, the norms for family, for gender, and both the men's movement and the women's movement are trying to do this. That's a very important partnership trend.
All right, so following on that, is there really danger now of a patriarchal backlash? And Laura, then how would you describe our current situation? You know, what factors do you think are thwarting this second cornerstone of gender relations and our progress into what you call that fifth spiritual paradigm?
Well, bringing the topic forward to the 21st century, we're absolutely seeing a backlash. There's no doubt about it. And I think it's exceedingly dangerous. And this regressive trend, as Rhian just said, is playing out in other arenas. The loss of democracy globally over the last 15 to 20 years, the loss of women's rights globally. So there's plenty of evidence that this is occurring. In fact, I recently learned that the Heritage Foundation, which is a right-wing think tank, has launched a program called Project 2025. And it is their plan to institutionalize a Christian nationalist agenda nationwide. So we're not imagining things, ladies. We are absolutely under assault. Also, recent Pew reports are revealing that although evangelical Christianity is slowly declining nationwide, it's actually fueling what we call the God gap. And that's the culture war between those who are taking off for new, you know, stimulating and more sophisticated views of deity, and those who are still wedded to these ancient religions. So this polarization is going to get worse, I think, before it gets any better. And the God gap sort of represents what's happened economically as well. We've winnowed out the middle class. So it's a similar notion, but applied to stages of consciousness and how humans view deity. Now, currently, science and spirituality are merging, and that's going to be very beneficial for us moving into this next paradigm, because it's giving even greater weight to the trending view that God is an energetic force. You know, adults today, when asked, will describe God as either truth or unity or the field of consciousness or the Akashic records. So fewer and fewer people are viewing God as a guy in the sky. All right. They're depersonifying deity, which is really good for where the evolutionary impulse wants to take us. I also think that we're witnessing a last ditch effort, which, you know, we saw during the last paradigm shift, the Roman Empire collapsed. And that was when polytheism was transforming into what I call daddy deism. And that was a last ditch effort on the part of the Roman Empire to try to conserve its power. But, you know, it led to the Dark Ages. So it's another reason why this is an exceedingly dangerous period of time. And similarly to the last paradigm shift, we could go into an even further stage of regression, which is what obviously we want to avoid. So until we are able to, in a holistic, healthy manner, get these pockets of hierarchical and patriarchal control lessened, we haven't seen the end of this regressionary stage, in my opinion.
All right, so let's take a look at this current attack on women's rights. So, Rian, given this recent attack on women's rights, including the right of free choice on abortion and other reproductive health care issues, what are some practical measures that can be taken to halt this alarming backlash against women, which then, as we all know, then spills over to all other forms of hierarchical discrimination against all minority groups?
Well, I want to elaborate on this a little bit, on what you just said, that it spills over to hierarchical discrimination against all out groups rather than in groups. And of course, minority groups are by definition out groups, as is the majority, the female gender, even though it's a majority. And I think that the attack on women's rights is fundamental, foundational to the really fierce resistance of those who have frankly been brainwashed. They're in what I call a domination trance, starting in families. This is all described in detail in Nurturing Our Humanity, drawing on research, by the way, on the prevalence of trauma, for example, the ACEs studies. And it does start in domination-oriented families, where people learn denial. I mean, they're dependent on the people who are causing them pain, aren't they? For food, for a place to live, for survival. So, and they are told also about the in-group of mankind and the female other, being inferior, being there to be dominated, being there to serve, right? And what they learn is to equate difference with either superiority or inferiority, with either dominating or being dominated, with either being served or serving. And then that is, can be applied and is applied, of course. It's a simultaneous process to a different race, to a different religion, to a different sexual orientation, a different ethnicity, anything. So I really want to say that, yes, it is an attack on women's rights, but it goes to one of the primary cornerstones on which either partnership or domination-oriented systems are built. This is not coincidental. Hitler in Germany, Stalin in the former USSR, you know, right is left is secular, Khomeini, you know, religious, Iran, Eastern, the Taliban, religious, Eastern, Putin in Russia. I cannot emphasize these commonalities. His normative ideal for family is the male-headed, top-down family in which women serve. This is not coincidental. This is not traditional, because remember, we spoke about much more ancient traditions, but it is what they cling to because it is foundational. So what can we do? We have to recognize, as I said, and I'll repeat this, that gender is a primary socioeconomic family organizing principle. And we have to pay much, much more attention to it than has been the norm. And we have to reclaim family morality. We have to change the norms from domination norms to partnership norms. And it's very ironic, and I really want to stop, that people who consider themselves, quote, Christian, are so into this in-group versus out-group, into hatred, into anger. But it all stems from the denial and the repression and the deflection of this anger and this pain and this fear to the, quote, out-group. Starting with Eve, remember that story? Oh, it's brilliant. Let's blame woman from whose body life ensues, right? For all of humanity's ills.
Yeah, so following on that, let's feature now Laura's work with regard to women's rights. So Laura, tell our listeners about that, and also particularly what you're dealing with in Grayson County, Virginia, where Oracle has been working in that area where the Texas Right to Life and Federalist Society have been proposing this so-called unborn sanctuary ordinance. So tell us about this whole landscape that you're working in now.
Well, it definitely wasn't on my calendar, but it's looking very much like we're going to have to bring suit in the county where I live. So I'm in Virginia, where our state statute tracks the trimester template of Roe v. Wade almost perfectly. Nevertheless, Texas Right to Life has chosen our little town of Independence, Virginia, to try to bring one of their unborn sanctuary ordinances and see if our local board of supervisors will pass it. These unborn sanctuary ordinances have been passed west of the Mississippi, but this is the first time they've come to a blue state. And as luck would have it, they chose our little town. So I think, and they knew that this southern town in Virginia would be susceptible to this sort of culture war issue. So I have had to sue the county twice before. The first time they were going to put a prison on that river behind me right after we had purchased the property for Oracle Campus, and we were victorious in getting the prison moved. The second time was they wouldn't give me the building permit for the Peace Pentagon, which is our headquarters. And that was sort of payback for the prison controversy, because the county wanted the prison. Anyway, that was the second time we sued. And during that public hearing, it turned into a Jesus revival. And as a result, we were able to take the transcript, send it to the Obama Justice Department, and they were just about to weigh in when the county finally settled the suit. But we sued, even though it was a zoning issue, we sued on the First Amendment. We sort of sued on the Virginia Act for Religious Freedom, which happens to be our own mission statement. So there's some poetic justice there. So now I might need to sue again, because it's looking like our very conservative local board of supervisors is going to pass this ordinance, which is ridiculous legally on multiple levels. And it's nice that Rhianne and I are both attorneys, because I'm sure she's seeing immediately how you can't do that. A municipality cannot in any way try to abrogate state level law. Nevertheless, they're going to do it. And I just wanted to mention that that's what's happening around the nation is Roe was decided under the 14th Amendment via an extension of privacy rights. No one has ever tested the First Amendment religious freedom argument as to a woman's right to choose. And that's what's happening right now around the nation. And that's the argument we would make in this upcoming lawsuit. The other irony is that people are suing on the Religious Freedom and Restoration Act, which Christian evangelicals were the ones who pushed this act through Congress and their state level versions of this statute. So it's just sort of amusing for us in the legal community to know that, you know, what goes around comes around. We're using the statute now ourselves for religious freedom. I want to mention that most of these suits are being filed by Jewish plaintiffs because they believe personhood starts with first breath. Muslims, on the other hand, scholars in the Islamic tradition believe that ensoulment takes place at 120 days. So the point is, back to the trickle-down deity theory, your view on abortion and pretty much every other topic is related to your view of God. An atheist, of course, would have a totally different take on abortion, I am sure. So the one thing that is clear is that most Americans do support a woman's right to choose. And I'm actually hoping that this becomes a central issue that can rally women. And of course, it's not our only issue. And Rianne does a better job than I can in listing all the ways in which hidden or blatant misogyny impacts everybody, economically, with regard to family issues and health and education and in every way we can think of in terms of civilized society. And women are pulling together. So I just want to give a couple examples. The impact on the military is already being felt. Female military personnel do not want to be stationed in southern states where abortion is banned. Similarly, most young doctors don't want to do residencies or work at hospitals in states where abortion is banned. And right now, a majority of medical students are female. We're also seeing the impact on college decisions. Applications. Young women are not applying to colleges at the same rate as they were before the reversal of Roe v. Wade. And we're seeing a doubling in some instances of sterilization procedures. Women are going and getting sterilized because they don't want to risk an unwanted pregnancy. So we're seeing all sorts of ramifications on the legal side and on the societal side. And yes, or this is very important to us, and women's rights has pretty much made its way to the top of our peace totem pole in terms of what we wish to work on.
Wow. So we're definitely seeing the whole importance here of the underlying narrative. So let's actually review now this importance of the narrative, and particularly the feminine narrative. Now, Rianne, it seems that to challenge this apparent slippage with regard to women's and women's rights, we're going to need to anchor this new narrative of partnerism in all of its attendant benefits, not only for women, but also for men. And this is, in fact, your fourth cornerstones, which sets forth the goal of telling new stories and using new language to reestablish the partnership model. So please tell us which of the, about these new stories that can assist the evolutionary impulse toward partnerism.
Well, I'd love to. And first, though, I really want to commend Laura for the incredibly important work that you're doing using the law, because we have to, being silent, which so many people are, unfortunately, is complicity. I mean, we saw that in Nazi Europe. And by the way, just personally, I mean, as a refugee child from the Holocaust with my parents, I can tell you that the story matters. The story that Jews, people like me, are subhuman and deserve to be killed, almost killed me. I mean, these are life and death issues. Oh, it's just a story. No, it's not just a story. It is a life and death issue at this point. So the first story that we really have to frontally challenge is the story that actually, whether it's selfish genes or whether it's original sin, it's the story about human nature. You know, it's really the same story about selfish genes and original sin, isn't it? We're bad. We're innately that way. Nothing to be done about it, except we need to be rigidly controlled from the top. You know, fear of God. I mean, that is sums it up in a sense. Yes, neuroscience tells a very different story about human nature. And again, I refer you to Nurturing Our Humanity. It's in there in detail. But look what neuroscience, well, to give just one example, the so-called pleasure centers of our brains light up more when we care and share than when we win or dominate. I mean, right there, you've got a very different story of, quote, human nature. Yes, we have the capacity to be cruel, to be violent, to be destructive. I mean, if we didn't have that capacity, we wouldn't have seen it. But whether that capacity is expressed is not a matter of genes, but of gene expression. And I cannot emphasize these four cornerstones enough, because they are foundational to what of our human repertoire, caring, consciousness, creativity, or moving to the domination side, and it's always a matter of degree, of course, cruelty, insensitivity, destructiveness, violence are expressed. This is not that it's innate, but it is a combination of our genetic potential and our cultural, starting with families, but going on with economics, education, religion, politics, etc. So there is this spiritual element, although I really hesitate to call what passes for spirituality in the current backlash of so-called Christian American nativism, because that is not spiritual and it certainly is not Christian. So anyway, I think we have to start with that, but we also have to change the story about childhood, about gender, about economics. I mean, why is there always money for prisons? You know, isn't that the punitive male head of household? Or for weapons, isn't that the iconic domination archetype of the hero as killer, as warrior, right? But somehow there isn't enough money for nurturing children, for caring for children, for feeding children, or for the people who do this caring, which is primarily women. And yes, also primarily people of color in these United States. I mean, these are not accidental patterns. This is coded feminine, it's coded outgroup, and now we have a gendered system of values. So we need stories that really show this. And I cannot emphasize that all of these four cornerstones, these four relational dynamics, we need to focus on them. And I really commend you, Laura, for the work that you're doing, especially this work of relating the gender element, frankly, to what kind of world we live in.
Right. So we're actually going to be continuing in these next two topics, really, just to extend this discussion. So let's talk now about the role of religion and particularly churches in shaping this emerging divine feminine narrative. So Laura, we're really interested to hear about what the Oracle Institute is doing to lay the foundation for a new narrative that strengthens partnerism and what you call the fifth spiritual paradigm. So tell us what you see as critical messaging at this spiritual level.
Well, first, I do wholeheartedly agree that a new paradigm needs a new story. And therefore, we need even new archetypes, and I believe new religions. We started a church in 2015 called Oracle Temple. And we founded this church on a redefinition of the Godhead. And it's where things are moving in terms of this merger of science and spirituality. So at Oracle Temple, we don't believe that God is a man, which is the last paradigm. That's the fourth paradigm. And incidentally, the Church of England recently rejected the notion that God is a man, and that caused quite a controversy in England. But neither do we believe God is a woman. That would be like a second paradigm concept, and that would be going back in time. Rather, what we feel is that God is a non-dual energetic force that you can think of as genderful if you wish, but also genderless. And this truly is where more and more humans globally are moving in terms of their concept of deity. So until recently, this reemergence of the divine feminine has been treated by the New Age movement as almost a return to these ancient goddesses, you know, Isis, Athena, and even the dark side of the mother, Kali. But reverting to goddess worship is not what we're talking about, and it's not the answer. Instead, more and more humans truly are ready for a more sophisticated view of deity, when it's balanced, it's integrated, and again, just more sophisticated. So we see this principle of divine union as central to the new narrative. And fortunately, the esoteric paths of all the great religions do have this principle. It's just not taught in the Orthodox churches, and in fundamentalist churches, you won't hear anything about divine feminine energy. But for instance, in the Gnostic Kabbalah, it's just immediately the tree of life has a masculine and a feminine pillar. And the upper triad is Bina the mother, Hokmah the father, and Keter the crown. And that's the non-dual God mind. So at our church, we're stressing paths like that, that teach if you like to envision the Trinity, what the true Trinity is. And I also love Ken Wilber's true Trinity. It is thou art and I am. Just throwing that in there. Big Ken Wilber fan. And at our church, we're also stressing this beautiful, long overdue merger of science and spirituality. And as an evolutionary leader, we've been helping out with and supporting the Hollow Movement, which is an initiative to help educate people on the principle of holism, which is overtaking rapidly the old story of materialism and reductionism. And again, tying it back to religion, the Hermetic path, which is actually quite ancient, the very first law of the seven laws of the universe is the law of gender. And these principles are nested and holarchical. So for people who are spiritual, I like to refer them either to the Kabbalah or to Hermeticism, because these ancient paths still hold, you know, well-worn keys to reaching higher states of awareness, consciousness, and enlightenment. Another thing we're doing through our church is we're spearheading the Women of Faith and Fury campaign, because we wish to reclaim the narrative of the Divine Mother and the spiritual nurturing that she represents. So Women of Faith and Fury is a campaign to sync up with other interfaith and progressive churches. Also, atheists are invited to join this campaign. And again, we're focusing on reproductive rights predominantly, but it's well beyond that. So I'm very much hoping that churches will help craft the new narrative. Again, not through some, you know, tapping back into polytheism or the goddesses of old, because we really do need new archetypes, new female role models, a new vision of deity primarily.
All right, so let's get Rian's take now on how religion really is a part of crafting this new narrative. So Rian, I think you agree, and please elaborate, that religion at its best and where it could go, and particularly with regard to the First Amendment, are really where this fertile ground is for advancing a new narrative, and one particularly that honors women and their place and their rights.
I definitely feel that way. And I have to say that while I personally think that many of us are ready for what you're talking about, Laura, a recognition that interconnection, which science is showing, I mean, Nobel Prizes have been given for that, and religion really are beginning to converge in that regard. I think that people are at various levels. And for people who are still into this God as a person, so to speak, I think it is important to really let them understand that this, what you call daddyism, I love that, is a new phenomenon, and that it wasn't always this way. And as for the Kabbalah, you know, in my book, Sacred Pleasure, and I really highly recommend that book because, I mean, domination systems are held together by fear of pain, whereas partnership systems are much more. We see it, for example, in the bonobos, our closest non-human primate relatives are held together more by sharing of pleasure, be it sexual pleasure, be it sharing food, etc. But in that book, I make the suggestion that the Kabbalah was actually kind of an attempt to disguise the old teachings so that the chokhmah or the, what is it in Greek? The, you know, the wisdom, Sophia, she's there, but she's not quite at the level of God, the daddy, right? And that it was really an attempt to hide her somehow in that. And I think that we need to reclaim the divine feminine. And if we're talking about interconnection, we need to talk about the interconnection between women and men in order to nothing less than perpetuate our species. Well, sacred pleasure really looks at both spirituality and sexuality, and they used to be related, as the book points out, using the lens of the partnership domination social scale. There's so much, and it's fascinating, really, the new stories. I mean, speaking of new stories, they're old stories, but it's like a Sherlock Holmes, you know, trying to put the jigsaw puzzle together in some way that actually makes sense. I mean, one of the big comments I get about my work is, oh, so that's how it was. I've always felt that it was, but I didn't have the evidence. I didn't have even the language because we're so stuck in capitalism versus socialism or socialism versus capitalism when both really perpetuate this. And I did say I'd talk about this, so let me talk about it because it's very, very important. If you think about both of these theories, which came out of early industrial times, you know, the 1700s, the 1800s, and we're now in the 21st century, post-industrial knowledge service age. They're antiquated, right? But even though both challenged traditions of domination, you know, Smith's capitalism challenged mercantilism, you know, kings, nobles, etc., controlling, you know, top, they challenged domination economics, but created what Marx then came along and challenged, which is the bourgeoisie taking over and being the people on top. But they both perpetuated this hidden system of values. So for both Smith and Marx, there is nothing in their theories about caring for nature. Nature is there to be exploited. And number two, caring for people starting at birth, that's to be performed for free by a woman in a male-controlled household. And hence they coded it reproductive rather than productive. And we have to change this mindset, which infects not only our economic operating systems, but our metrics. And that's a whole new chapter that there isn't time to talk about, but one of the interventions, and you can find out more about it at centerforpartnership.org. But I think that it's systems change that's needed. And yes, the environment is a reason, and I know I'm jumping ahead, for hope, because some of us are waking up and saying, oh my gosh, the old domination system is taking us to an evolutionary dead end. I mean, cockroaches will survive, but maybe we won't, you know? So we really have to pay attention. So that's where I'm going to stop right now.
Yeah, so great. So this gives us a great way that we can turn now to this discussion of the need and the direction of a new global women's movement. So Laura, in addition to crafting this new spiritual path, a new definition of Godhead, what are the other avenues that you're seeing and actions toward renewing this partnership narrative?
Well, I do think we need to do more than try to update the old religions, and even more than develop new spiritual paths, because we are in the thick of it right now, what we at Oracle call a great cusp. So this is the period in between two paradigms. So we're in between Daddy Deism and this new paradigm, which is desperately trying to be birthed. And these periods are always exceedingly dangerous. They can go either way in terms of progress or regression. And the hallmark of them is the type of socio-spiritual chaos we're witnessing right now. And they always end, great cusps always end with an end, with a big bang. And we want to make sure the big bang propels us forward and not backward. So we think that this current great cusp is the most dangerous in human history. It's the first time we've had weapons of mass destruction. It's the first time the planet has been in peril. And what we're seeing, because of the great cusp, we're seeing the dominator model being pushed to its extremes. This is Rian was talking about. Putin is a perfect example. The fact that Trump has such a great following in this country is another big example. So we're seeing totalitarianism taking hold. We're seeing these patriarchal theocracies not losing ground, and in fact, trying to gain ground here in the form of Christian nationalism. And, you know, The Handmaid's Tale, the book, was written back in 1985. And that's a long time ago. And, you know, at the time, it seemed to be this harmless dystopian fiction. It's the kind of a books my mother loves, actually. But here we are. Here we are in a timeline that could actually lead to something as hellacious as A Handmaid's Tale reality for women. So I do think we need a movement. I think we need a real movement. And by that, I mean, in the Gandhian sense, in the Martin Luther King sense of the term. I think it's imperative for America and for the world that women come together and join in a well-organized, unified force. And it's one of the projects that we brainstorm on all the time at the Oracle Institute. We really, truly believe that a global women's strike is the answer. We're running out of time, so I'm not going to go into the details of what we've sort of sketched out, but it would be a very well-planned, well-orchestrated event where the world gets plenty of time to ponder the proposals and actually the demands that we would make. And these sorts of strikes have worked in the past. In 1961, there was an incredibly powerful women's strike for peace. There was another one in 1970. One of the most famous ones is the 1975 Icelandic women's strike. And 90% of the women of that country participated, and that was over wages. So there's precedent for this. I think we can pull it together. And I think we should use as sort of a rallying cry, Julia Ward Howe's Mother's Day Proclamation, which if you've never read it, please do. I personally can't read it without crying. And what she was doing was calling for a Congress of women after the end of the Civil War. And what ended up happening is Mother's Day got turned into a Hallmark card event. But the true origin of Mother's Day has to do with this proclamation, which is not only incredibly beautifully written and inspiring it also is more timely than ever. So more on the women's strike to come. But just, you know, a couple of the demands would be, for instance, Equal Rights Amendment finally getting passed. By the way, Virginia was the 38th state. It should have gone through. It's being hung up on all these technicalities. So that would be one of the demands. And I'll hold off the rest. But we have been brainstorming this for a number of years and really feel it's time. Global women's strike. Let's do it, sisters.
All right. So as we move toward closing, and this has really been what a landscape, this discussion, get some final thoughts from Rianne on how to not only elevate the status of women globally, but have that be so key to this reestablishment of the partnership cultural model. Now, Rianne, you're clearly not alone in believing that the elevation of women is key to permanently establishing a partnership culture. And for instance, the United Nations Sustainable Development Goal number 5 states this need to achieve gender equality to empower women and girls all around the world. And likewise, Al Gore in the Nobel Prize winning Climate Reality Projects lists gender equality as the key to sustainability and also to a healthy global population. So before we close, what would be your final thoughts that you'd like to share on how we can elevate the position of women worldwide in that way that furthers the partnership global culture?
Well, the so-called feminine, what's quoted feminine, these are human values. You know, we all, I mean, my late husband was a very caring man, and we all know women who are cruel and not caring. So this is not a question of women against men or men against women. And while I love the idea, Laura, of the women's strike, I think that its rallying cry should be partnerism, because there are men who also, there's a whole men's movement to redefine, quote, masculinity, that we need to recognize it's not enough to redefine femininity. If you look at some of the nations that have moved more closely to the partnership side, like Finland, like Norway, like Sweden, they have 50%, yes, almost 50% of the national legislatures are female. There has been a rise in the status of women. But with it has also come a rise in so-called feminine, coded feminine values of caring for people. They have very generous paid parental leave for both mothers and fathers. They invest heavily in good quality and well-paid child care. Their normative ideal for family, just as their normative ideal for parliamentary governance, is to have both men and women be caregivers, as well as having careers. And I think we must show, well, look, I mean, in the domination system, men have had to lose nothing less than give their lives because some guy on top, like a Putin today, wants more real estate. I mean, it's a miserable model. We have to both women, men, and everyone in between who doesn't exist in that paradigm, you know, in the domination paradigm, loses part of their humanity. So I would suggest that the rallying cry be partnership, because that is what women really want for the most part, and caring, a caring economics of partnerism, as I suggest in my book, The Real Wealth of Nations, which the subtitle is Creating a Caring Economics, which requires, again, raising the status of women and the so-called feminine in women, men, everybody in between, and in social and economic policy.
All right. So, Laura, let's get some final thoughts from you, and especially because we know that you're going to be co-leading a new collaboratory of evolutionary leaders synergy circles on women's issues, the divine feminine, divine child, and ultimately, of course, partnerism. and perhaps a dozen synergy circles across an incredibly diverse thematic and activist areas of engagement are going to be involved, including members of the Cornerstone Synergy Circle, which actually hosts this series and which Rianne co-founded. So Laura, tell us a bit about what's emerging with this new collaboratory initiative.
Well, I'm very honored to be one of the people who are helping to found this circle, which is based on the work of so many, including the woman I'm speaking with tonight, Rianne. It's been such an honor. So this is going to be a new synergy circle, and synergy circle is the term that we use at the Evolutionary Leaders Circle to describe sort of think tank level brainstorming committees. And we've decided that women's issues absolutely deserves its own synergy circle. So we'll be drawing from the others. All these other synergy circles have amazing talent and wisdom. And so some of the people are going to be joining us, just to give you an example. Dr. Eisler will be there, and she's bringing both her system science knowledge and comprehension of the world and how it works, and also science and how holism works, to bear on this committee. We've also got Jude Kuravant coming in. She is a world-renowned cosmologist who also sees where the evolutionary impulse is taking us, and is designing new narratives and new stories for us to share to help partnership become our new reality. We've got a few lawyers involved. Denise Scotto is going to be involved. She's a women's rights attorney. In the Evolutionary Leaders, she's on the yoga and spirituality synergy circle, but that's sort of how we roll in the Evolutionary Leaders. We get to both work hard intellectually and play hard by following our passions. Another woman joining us is Kristen Hoffman, an amazing singer-songwriter. She sang and performed the new Hala Movement theme song, which, just like Julia Ward Howe's Mother's Day proclamation, I cannot listen to that song without crying. So Kristen will be with us. Also in media, from Illuminate Film Festival, Diane Wolpert's going to be part of the Synergy Circle. And yet another system scientist is Annalise Smitsman, who is, in addition, an attorney. We got a few lawyers on this committee. And she is the brain behind Earthwise Constitution, which is a global effort to bring planetary peace, prosperity, and holism to us all. So very excited about this new synergy circle, very excited to be one of the conveners. And again, so honored to be with you tonight, Rianne. And also you, Kurt, thank you so much for inviting me on.
Yeah, no, absolutely. We're really excited because, as Laura said, the Evolutionary Leaders, if you look at evolutionaryleaders.net, see all their pictures and say, oh my God, that's my bookshelf. And the 23 areas of engagement, when we started talking about what do we do now with regard to the women's issues worldwide, we said it just can't be a new synergy circle. It has to be a collaboratory of all of the circles that are bringing every aspect of this: climate change, governance, social justice, all the other 23 areas of engagement. So we're really so pleased at where that's going. So thank you so much, Rianne Eisler and Laura George, for joining us for this discussion on the foundational questions of our time. Thank you so much for joining us in these video discussions of the Synergy Circles Collaboratory of the Evolutionary Leaders, a project of the Source of Synergy Foundation. In this collaboratory, 23 activist circles across diverse areas of activist engagement bring you important discussions on the topics portrayed in the banners of this series and the discussions that you have just heard from prominent global thought leaders. So crucially needed if our world is to move from dominance consciousness and dominance cultures to partnership consciousness and partnership cultures. You can learn more at evolutionaryleaders.net/synergycircles, where you'll find out more also about our Igniting the Holo movement. That's HOLO movement.net. and at all the other links that follow in the credits directly hereafter. Thank you for joining us in this era of emerging networks of networks, so desperately needed for our achievement of a world that works for all.